John Seely Brown, John Hagel, co-authors of The Power of Pull. John Hagel, how do we get to pull? Is it through education?
Well, unfortunately, our educational system is a classic example of a push institution. Basically, the minute you're born, they can tell you what you're going to learn in first grade, third grade, 12th grade, all the way through. So it's not just companies that are based on a push model. All our educational systems are as well. So I think it's less around the educational system as the catalyst for change and much more about individuals starting to master the power of pull in their individual lives and bringing that into the workplace in ways that will start to drive performance improvement in the institutions so that they start to see the potential and start to move in this direction. But it's not typically the educational system that will be the catalyst here.
John Seely Brown, a couple of weeks ago, we had Poe Bronson in the studio who was talking about the crisis of creativity in American schools, which I assume is connected with the crisis of the push economy. What is the role, in your view, of education? It's all very well to say it's up to individuals to realize what you call the big shift, but can we rely on individuals to motivate themselves? Don't they have to be educated in all this?
Well, I think first of all, you got to realize that there are multiple ways to educate people. The way we have been educating them in the 20th century and some of them right now is that we basically put them in a factory model of education. We tell them they have to perfect these skills. We test the hell out of them and basically drill and practice. So in fact, there's nothing that we do today in school systems that really stimulate the imagination. You know, your prior person was talking about creativity. I want to shift it to imagination. What actually generates imagination? Because in a rapidly changing world, you got to be able to imagine what could be. And then we have all kinds of techniques, once you imagine what you can do, how to creatively pursue that. But if you can't imagine, creativity doesn't matter. So in some sense, we think that kind of imagination comes first, then creativity, and then the ability to pull tools, resources, information, folks around you to actually be able to create things. And you know, you've written some on the amateur culture communities, et cetera, et cetera. Do what I am, you do it yourself. You know, we changed DIY, do it yourself, to DIT, do it with others. And the whole sense of, can we find people to come together to be able to create things for us, with us, around us as we move forward. The real question is, are we moving into an era in which the notion of personal identity is changing? In the past, personal identity was defined by what I own, what I wear, what I control, and so on. I think we're moving into a world where basically identity is going to be crafted more and more by what can I create, share with others, and that they can build on to do more things with. And so we may be kind of returning to almost a form of the craft economy and saying, I am part of what I can create and others can build and appreciate and do things with. So that's quite a major shift. Now, if you move into that point of view, imagination can't help but be with you. Everything around, you can look at kind of what can I imagine versus what am I currently facing, and now how do I get from here to there? And what we're really saying in The Power of Pull is once you can imagine something new, then you can actually pull infinite sets of resources and communities around you to make actually something interestingly happen. So we're throwing the responsibility back from the education system onto the individuals to kind of craft their own future, to decide on a trajectory that actually they want to passionately believe in, and then suggest that the individual has amazing access today in terms of information resources, people resources, and power tools to make anything, almost anything happen.
John Hagel, John, your co-chair's message, I think, would be would resonate in Silicon Valley, in Palo Alto, in the wealthier neighborhoods of San Francisco. But how do you explain this in Oakland? What would you tell a 15-year-old kid about this who doesn't have the advantages that most of us have grown up with?
Well, I think increasingly what is exciting about this new world is the tools and tech platforms that are available for creativity of various forms, whether it's hip-hop music or some kind of construction, a hacking of technology. is available virtually to everyone, even in Oakland. You have the access through centers that share these resources to be able to do some of this stuff. So I think the key message that we have to people wherever they are is the notion of finding a passion, finding something you're really excited about, and using these tools and platforms and connecting with others that share this passion. So it's not just you trying to do something, but you're bringing together a group of people who share that passion and do it.